Good afternoon, everyone. I'm thankful to the organizers and very excited to be here to present our work. This is a very the data is very warm, so it's exciting to see the results. A few years back, we were interested in studying inclusive growth, and we wanted to construct a consumption profile for countries within and across, and look at people within and across countries. And we attempted to do that initially with the existing data sets. But we found that it was a very difficult effort, both in terms of methods were not clear and replicability was not there. So we embarked on an effort to create a database from scratch. My co-authors here are Arjun Jayadev and Sanjay Reddy. At the outset, before I start, let me tell you that developing a global data set which captures, gives a consumption profile is a very difficult exercise, as you know from yesterday's discussions also. So we do not claim here that we know the best answers to everything, but we are working on what has previously been done and trying to improve certain things. And we are very open and flexible to your suggestions as well as ideas. So let me start. What is GCIP? The Global Consumption and Income Project is basically consists of two global data sets, a consumption data set and an income data set, which will give us a portrait of consumption and income within and across countries over time. Our main goal to start the project was we wanted to be open and transparent. We want to provide both the code as well as data so that it's replicable, as well as people can change our methods, use alternative assumptions, and see how it looks. The benchmark database which we currently have gives us a consumption profile and a separate income profile for around 133 countries spanning the last half century, which is 1960 to 2012. We have inbuilt tools for filling in missing data, as well as creating portraits for aggregates of countries. A user can create an aggregate for any country they want. Sorry, these slides are just moving. The applications which we currently think about are tracking the evolution of material living standards over time, as well as using the database we can calculate any poverty measure, any inequality measure, and inclusive growth measure. Researchers might use it to both explain the consequences and the causes of inequality, but we expect that once the data is public, people will use it in many more ways. So what is unique about GCIP? And there are several things. A few are, we provide annual portraits of consumption and income. Most current data sets have choose some benchmark years and pick surveys. We do annual portrait, and I'll get to why that is important in a minute. We have a broader temporal and geographical reach going back, say, 50 years. We provide separate consumption and income estimates. Several data sets currently mix income and consumption distributions as well as mean incomes and use them interchangeably. We think that is wrong because these are two different concepts. So we try to get at a separate consumption and an income estimate. We provide tools for aggregation of user-defined countries, groups of countries. So a user may specify that they are interested in BRICS or any group of three or four countries or a larger grouping, and you can get a consumption portrait out of it. And as I mentioned earlier, we'll provide full documentation of our methods. Coming to construction of the data set, we have four steps. The first step is we collect data on relative consumption or income distributions. The second is we standardize the distributions. This is not complete standardization, but we convert the consumption distributions into equivalent income distributions and vice versa. I'll come to the details of each of these steps. In the third step, we obtain an estimate of mean consumption from the surveys because we are interested both in the means as well as the both in the levels as well as the distribution. In the fourth step, using these two, we create a consumption and income profile. So the first step is, currently our data sources are UNUWIDER, WIAD, PovCalNet and LIS. But we are open in principle to get data from other sources. A restriction which we put on our data is we restrict all our universe to per capita surveys. Per capita survey has the benefit that they are easy to understand, they have a counterpart in GDP. The side effect, the negative point is they do not account for economies of scale. But they are also the most commonly used. Lastly is for country years, we find after collecting the data, for several country years there would be multiple surveys. So using the Canberra group recommendations and our own measures, we apply a lexicographical ordering to get at a single survey for every year. The ordering, basically we prefer surveys which have mean information over surveys which do not have mean information. For the consumption survey, we prefer consumption surveys when there is a choice. Income surveys that are closer to arriving at a total net income concept are preferred. But we do not, here I want to mention that we do not standardize the income concept across the board, because we found that that not to be possible because of lack of data. We prefer surveys from PovCalNet over LIS and WIAD. This is mainly because PovCalNet and LIS have better means data than WIAD and some other criteria. So in the second step, we convert income distributions to consumption for our GCD database and vice versa for the other database. So how do we do this? WIAD has around 120 country years, which has both a consumption survey and an income survey for the same country for the same year. We use that to get a relationship at the quintile share level. So for each quintile, we do a regression and get a relationship of how the shares are related. So you'll find that the relationships will vary by quintile. For the bottom quintile, you'll find that the consumption share comes out to be 1.85 times the income share. Whereas in the top quintile, it's the reverse. This consumption share is 0.86 times the income share. This is a univariate regression. We tried out other alternative specifications, but we found that this worked the best. But again, this is a work in progress, and we are open to other alternatives here. Adjusted R-squares are pretty high and our confidence intervals are low. So we are a bit confident of these results. Let me show an example of how this works. This is Mexico 1989, which has an income survey. We want to convert it into an equivalent consumption survey. The original income shares are in these columns. And we applied the regression coefficients mentioned earlier to get these shares, which is bottom moves from 3.93 to 4.66. But you will find that because there are five different regressions, this doesn't add up to 100. So the choice which we made here was whatever shortfall is equally proportionally distributed across the five quintiles. So now you have the bottom moves from 3.93 to 4.81, whereas the top share has moved from 56 income share to an equivalent consumption share of 50.23. We do this across the data set wherever we have an income survey for the global consumption data set and the reverse for the income data set. Coming to the third step, now we determine the mean levels. We prefer, we use survey means, we do not use national account means. So, in the first step, we get the means data from the surveys where we are getting the relative distributions from. If the mean is an income mean, we convert it into a consumption mean by using the consumption in nominal GDP ratio to get an equivalent consumption mean. This is the same method followed in earlier versions of PovCalNet. For survey years without survey means, we do interpolation or extrapolation by using growth rate data. I'll come to the exact interpolation method in a minute. And lastly, we convert all the consumption and income means to local 2005 LCU units, which are finally converted into 2005 PPP. Here, let me mention that we realized that there are several problems with PPPs. They are inherently flawed, and the results might be quite sensitive to Bayesians. But this is the first version where we are trying to first use PPPs, and at later point we'll try to show the sensitivity to PPPs. Now the fourth step is we estimate a Lorentz curve from the distribution data. We use the standard parametric regression methods to first prefer a GQ Lorentz curve, which is the generalized quadratic form. But if it fails to give a valid Lorentz curve, we fall back to beta Lorentz curves. At points, we have seen that both of them fail, and we choose a piecewise linear method, which is our own method. Once we have the Lorentz curves, Lorentz curves are not usually estimated by the most existing data sets. They assume an average, same average income for within deciles, which underestimates the within country inequalities. In the second stage, we use the mean and the estimated Lorentz curves to get the mean consumption and income levels for each decile, or we can go down to each ventile level. Now, this is all for the survey years, but there are several gaps because 1960 to 2012, there are many non-survey years. For that, we estimate the consumption and income profile by using the national accounts growth rate data to interpolate. Interpolate is when a non-survey year falls between two survey years. We use the growth rate data and the time-weighted average to get at the distribution and the mean levels. But if the survey falls before the first survey year or after the last survey year, then we extrapolate, again using the national account growth rates. So we have a database now. It's a global consumption database which has 1340 country year observations from 133 countries. 45% of these surveys are consumption surveys. All this data which I am showing is only for one data set, the GCD, not the GID. But if you look at by decade coverage, the coverage obviously in 60s and 70s is very poor. Around only 35 to 40 countries have surveys in this period. So there's a lot of extrapolation happening here. And we have to be cautious of results for 1960s and 70s. There are other things about 60s and 70s is we do not have data on planned economies. And so that is another reason to be cautious of these results. Overall, we find that PovCalNet forms around 26% of our surveys, 62% of our surveys. Now, preliminary results. As I mentioned before I present the results, there are several things to be cautious about. One is the data coverage in 60s and 70s, so we don't present much results in that period. Second is the PPPs, as I've mentioned. And third is that we do not currently make any adjustments for the non-coverage at the top level, but we plan to do that soon. So let's look at how these preliminary results look. This is a kernel density plot of consumption, log of consumption. You'll find that in the 60s and the 80s, you'll have two peaks. In the 2010, there's only a single peak, almost a single peak. This is basically the growth of China, which has filled in the middle part. These are the global generalized Lorentz curves. Generalized Lorentz curves are Lorentz curves scaled up by the means. And these are welfare implications. So here you'll find that 2010 clearly dominates 1990 and 2000 data. So everyone in 2010, according to this, is well off, at least in the consumption sense. 2000 barely dominates 1990. Global inequality, what has happened? It has declined from the 80s and 90s when it was in the 0.7 range to around 0.63 right now. But if you look at this, excluding China, the pattern looks different. And it's increased till 2000 and then a decline. Excluding India doesn't make that much of a difference. But again, here these are relative measures of inequality. And this might change once you use different measures.
Global poverty also has declined dramatically, but again, removing China doesn't show as dramatic a decline. These are global growth incidence curves plotting cumulative growth rates. You'll find the median has almost doubled over 1990 to 2010 period. This is where the Chinese population is in the global median, and the top, which is the developed country population, is stagnating. But again, this was the relative measure. The absolute measure looks different. The gains in the lower percentiles are still lower than the top percentile. So who is in the bottom quintile? So in the, you'll find that in the 60s and 80s, lots of Chinese were in the bottom quintile, around 60% of Chinese were. But now less than 20% of Chinese are in the bottom quintile. The space left behind by China is sort of occupied now by India and other countries. Indians which were not in the bottom quintile now are around 40% in the bottom quintile. What happens in the top decile? In the top decile, Korea shows a dramatic change. In the 80s, it was nowhere in the top decile. Now around 40% of Koreans are in the top decile. And there are several interesting results if you look at countries. Inequality estimates, I'll not go into details, but this is to show that you can use the aggregation module to aggregate any sort of countries, BRICS, or by region, or by any other user-defined countries. This is interesting. These are partial orderings. We wanted to take this data as well as life expectancy and look at how partial ordering of countries would look. This is for Asia-Pacific. So how this diagram operates is if there's a direct line connecting the two, and the one at the higher level dominates the lower level. So Japan here has a higher consumption profile, which means that it has higher consumption for each quintile as well as higher life expectancy. All of that vector is greater than in Korea. If the line does not connect two countries, then the domination, there's no relationship between those two. Here you'll find interesting results that India does not dominate any other country, so, and is dominated by Nepal and several other countries in this whole. This is just an illustration of an application of the data. This is for OECD countries. Here you'll find US does not dominate a lot of these countries, as well as Germany, Finland, Ireland, Israel. It dominates Spain, Korea, and at lower levels. This is for the world. I'll not again go into details, but this is just an interesting plot to understand the various relationships. So in short, GCIP is a resource for understanding. It's an evolution of material living standards within and across countries. It is a tool which can be used to study poverty, inequality, inclusiveness, and growth. The implications of alternative assumptions and robustness of conclusions. And we can study causal determinants of poverty, inequality, and inclusivity. Finally, to end, this is very much a work in progress, thus offers diverse possibilities. We plan to be flexible in our approach, as well as we are flexible and open to alternative methods and suggestions. We seek to build and improve on this database in the months and years to come with involvement of interested specialists and world public in general. You can follow us, this is just a web page right now, but you can follow us here at gcip.info. Thank you.